Now, in one of my stint in the past, I had a CEO who used to look at every possible metrics, and once he called and told me that, Mohan, we have spent so much money on this CBT, but only 2% people have used it. And I told him, if 100% people use it, we have hired a bunch of stupid guys. It's only 2% who did not know how to use it, so they have used it. So now I'll go back to Girish and Deb. This is a question which has come. You manage organizations which are interesting. The question is that, how do you identify right talent at very young age and groom them up?
What few things that we do in Swiggy is, first of all, and if you're talking about empowering people, right, we need to change our processes. So you can't tell that you'll empower people, but you know, the entire life is controlled by a line manager. He decides whom to hire, he decides whom to promote, he decides how much to give, he decides whom to fire. And then you're saying the employee is empowered. Right? So there's definitely a disconnect and dissonance with the people. So what we did is to identify talent, right? One is to remove individual taking a call on a person, right? So we always have a panel of interview, and the panel is 360. So there are people who interview our line managers, the people who are parallel to the guy or the incumbent who's being interviewed, there are people who work with him, right? So primarily what we're trying to do here is to just take away the power of hiring by one individual, because then obviously there are biases, right? So we get this 360 interview done, and then we come back and we do a debrief and actually sit in the, you know, debate on what are the qualities that we saw in an individual and really go through some very, very immersive conversations before we take a hiring call.
Right? Sure.
So that way we somewhere negate the effect of biases which can come.
I have another interesting question for you, Anivan, though I do not agree with the statement what they have made. He asks me, why do HR managers do not become CEOs? All the companies I worked for, except currently Subex, I have a CFO as my, he was a CFO, he's the CEO. I don't like it. But all earlier companies, Vinit was an Excel guy, Krishna Kumar Natarajan was an Excel guy. There are many HR people who have made it to the CEO. But however, the question is, why don't HR managers don't become CEO, unlike a head of marketing or finance head?
HR guys define themselves around HR, and in general, not everybody, they just don't take as much interest in the business in a way in which a marketing or a finance guy may do. In my own career, after about 3-4 years of HR, one of the reasons I switched over and decided to do consulting and learned SAP and became a solution architect, I was in PwC and then we were acquired by IBM. One of the reasons I did that was actually I made SAP into my lathe machine and decided to spend some time working in a line that I thought I'd do for 2-3 years and come back. I ended up doing about 7 years and then I came back. But I think that kind of gives me confidence today, even when I'm talking of an HR solution, to talk eye to eye with business and also show them that I'm empathic and I understand, you know, what is it that's going on, and it gives a respect. Mm-hmm. I would personally recommend to each HR person, if you get the opportunity, do put in a stint. I'm not saying for how long,
sure,
but do put in a stint in the business. You will become a lot more confident. If we have enough of those HR guys, maybe some of them will become CEOs.
Absolutely. So, we are coming towards the end of the conversation, and there is also another question, and I'll build it up. It would be so unfair that we are talking about HR futures and we do not answer that question. So if you have to tell me in one sentence, only one sentence, who is the future of HR, what would you say, sir?
I think HRs have to become expert generalist.
Expert?
Expert generalist.
Expert, yeah. Generalist.
So okay. First of all, understanding the entire facets of HR, not limiting to that, like they mentioned, understand business. 3 things to understand, right? Why does the business exist, right? The why is very, very important. Why does a consumer like us? Why does a partner like us? HR needs to understand that. Mm-hmm. What takes to make money, right? We need to understand what takes to make money. And the third is how. How can we do that better?
So HR is a business guy. HR has to get
HR has to understand business.
Okay. So, yes, sir.
My thought is, if today you are outsourcing everything, right? Including things of HR that are getting outsourced. So I say, how do you create a relevance for yourself? And how do you remain critical to the organization? So the question is, do you want to become like a security agency which can be outsourced any given day, and it's only incidental to the entire business? Or if somebody comes and asks the business whether they would prefer outsourcing what we do as HR and what the response of the business is, whether we are defining our future. If the business says, I'm absolutely fine, it's okay, doesn't matter to me if you outsource HR and whatever they do, then I know where I am heading. But if the business says, you cannot outsource HR because this is the value they bring to me, and I don't like anybody from outside doing what they
Why would business say that? Why would business?
Provided, they will say only if I have created that value.
Okay.
Will they do the same thing for finance? My question is, because the way the financial planning, the controls are getting managed, the strategic business numbers are getting, I mean, the finance person is normally the right-hand person of the CEO. Why? Can the HR person become the left-hand person or the right-hand person of the CEO?
So the question they still is that what should I do to be significant? I hear you. I have to be significant.
Yes.
What should I do? The way he said that I have to be a business guy.
Obviously. So that's the thing. So are you doing something which is, I mean, obviously it's a much repeated word, but are you strategic or are you doing something operational which anybody can do?
And you have anything apart from the floors you need to walk? I like that.
Yeah, I mean, very simple. I think I like what you said, the term that you used. I call the same thing versatilist. It's a Gartner term, which means HR has to very quickly go into depth, come out, and then go into depth in something else the next day. Most important, the only reason why they are going into depth is because they are solving a real business problem related to the 3 points that you said, okay? Why do we exist? How do we make money? And therefore, what is a business problem? How do I solve it doing HR with some deep competence I have? The rest of it all is orchestrating. Since it's future of HR, there's a lot of technology coming through. Cloud services is there. Microservices is there. It's about taking those and orchestrating a solution. But at the end of it, there has to be a core expertise that one brings to the table. And orchestrating all those services, using one's core expertise, and solving a real business problem. That's how I think the future of HR looks like.
Nagan.
All of whatever panelists have said, plus the future of HR is going to be the chief empathy officer. The reason being, the world is actually threatening the HR fraternity with bots and machines, and 35% of you will have no jobs, HR will be dead by 2020, and so on and so forth. But trust me, with invasion of technology, invasion of all these so-called Sophia, Alexa, Siri, and so and whatnot, trust me.
I don't know Sophia, I know only Alexa.
No, Sophia is a new, actually I learned a new term the other day, it's called metal collar workers in the future. The metal collar worker will be my colleague very soon, right? So imagine the stress and the trauma that human beings go through in competing with the metal collar workers in the future. I believe, forget being threatened away from your jobs. Trust me, world will come after all of you and all of us. Because while machines understand feelings, but trust me, you know very well that you're dealing with the machine. The very fact defeats the purpose. You need a human being who is like you and me to understand what I'm going through. So that empathy is extremely important. HR must acquire all the skills that my panelists have said, plus please understand human beings better and better as we go along. Thank you.
Absolutely. The conversation is that future of HR is a digital guy. He's a digital person. Obviously, I was in an SAP shop. We had to speak SAP. So, but honestly, I agree with you. In a way, a digital HR was of yesterday. If today I'm not digitally savvy, I still have a job, it's an accident. So the future of HR, I completely agree with you, when bots take over, what is going to bite us big time is going to be a mental health issues of our people. They are going to, if they have saved their jobs against the bots, they are going to be under multiplier of the stress level what they are today. I don't think the team in this room are equipped to manage mental health issues. Probably that could be the new thing. I would open it up. Thanks for fantastic conversation. I would open it up if there are any additional questions from the audience.
Morning, everybody. My name is Tyagraj. I have my own consultancy, Proactive Trainers and Consultants. See, if we adopt more and more digitized systems, that element becomes less and less. How is it that we can include it in spite of machine learning, in spite of emotional intelligence, in spite of Internet of Things working, still can we retain that emotional content when we deal with people? For example, olden days we used to apply leave. There will be a leave application and the employee goes to the boss and he tells why he wants the leave. Boss will listen. Oh, my wife is sick, or child is sick, or I have to go get married, whatever it is. That relationship and the mutual understanding was a basis. He knows where why he is going.
Sure.
Today, leave is applied on the line, and everything gets regularized through the system.
Sure.
I was just wondering, can that be one of the skills or abilities of the individual to build into this digital world and still maintain the emotional connect?
Sure.
Sir, I think emotional intelligence is most important in today's world. 20 years back, we did not hear about emotional intelligence. While Daniel Goleman started working mid of 90s, etc., but the subject was not known as much as it is today. And today, most organizations are actually working because there is a need felt, just because there is a dichotomy existing. As you talked about the leave, now, obviously, organizations are becoming bigger. Things are moving much faster. So people have less bandwidth to do operational stuff. Operational stuff is getting outsourced. So operational stuff getting outsourced is absolutely fine. But when it comes to the people connect, that's where you see every organization is talking about coaching. What's coaching? It's that person-to-person connect, right? Mentoring, coaching, a manager dealing with his team member as a mentor and a coach rather than a team member or a reportee is the part. That is where the emotional connect starts and ends. And that is the art that we have to understand. Coaching may be used as a term coaching, but emotional intelligence is all inbuilt. So I think it was no more relevant anywhere in the past than it is today, according to
Hi. So my question is more like your guidance or advice for the young HRs of next generation. So basically two things. So you spoke about most important skills are like from basically a business mindset and generalist and empathy. So if I would like to request you like a broad guideline, what are the activities that people need to do in their day-to-day job, like little more concrete that we have to watch out to consciously to do? One thing, one, two, three, and maybe what not to do, which is as important as what to do. Top one, two, three.
I'll give you a nice acronym. As HR professionals, we don't have to be in the pleasing mode of the northbound team, which is the top bosses. You don't have to please the bosses. I'm telling you the don'ts first, okay? The second thing is never try to please anybody. Speak the truth. Always truth prevails. Most people, what we do, in a eagerness to create a feeling of camaraderie, no, I will save you now and tomorrow you will save me. Never get into that game.
Don't agree 49%. Yeah. Disagree.
Yeah, very absolutely.
We
absolutely.
Get it.
Disagreement is a clear disagreement. Third thing is, never be fake. Be real. Be real who you are, speak real, speak from the heart. I would say a true HR person should be the one who has a firm head, a loving heart, and an action-oriented hand. Thoughts, feelings, and actions should be in harmony, and then actually everybody will accept you.
Sure.
Thank you.
You have a point.